What you're looking at is what is, in my humble opinion, one of math's most beautiful identities, the Pythagorean trig identity. Sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, and by the end of this video, I hope that you'll not just understand this mess of symbols, but also appreciate its beauty and hopefully learn some basic facts of trigonometry in the process. To begin, let's draw a unit circle. It has a radius of 1 and is centered on the origin. Every point in it has a distance of 1 to the origin. Now imagine a point rotating around that circle. We'll call its angle relative to the x-axis by the Greek letter phi, which is that squiggly line thing. Next, we'll draw a line from the point to the origin, then from the point down to the x-axis. Finally, we'll finish with a third line back to the origin. We just drew a right triangle, and this triangle is what trig is all about. This is what it looks like when we change our angle phi. You can see the triangle rotates around the circle, and the lengths of the sides seem to oscillate as we do this. Now for some notation. Every right triangle has three sides. We have a special way of labeling those sides. The red side is called the hypotenuse, or h. We call the blue side the opposite, because it is opposite of the angle of interest. Similarly, we call the green side the adjacent, or a, because it is adjacent to the angle of interest. But back to our setup. The trig functions are actually just the lengths of the sides of this triangle, or the x and y coordinates of a rotating point. We call the length of the adjacent cosine phi, which is the same as the x-coordinate of our point, and we call the length of the opposite sine of phi, which is the same as the y-coordinate of our point. Since these vary as we change our angle, we write them as functions of our angle. We can also define sine and cosine in terms of circles with any radius other than 1. We just divide the lengths of the opposite and adjacent through by the hypotenuse, the radius of the circle, to get the values of sine and cosine. If you've studied trig in school, you probably learned the trig functions this way. We'll make use of this fact at the end of the video. You might notice that as the triangle rotates around the circle, the lengths of the opposite and adjacent oscillate. In fact, when we plot them relative to the angle, we get two oscillating waves, one slightly shifted to the right from the other. These are sine and cosine waves. Sine is blue here, and cosine is green. And in a similar vein, the way we draw circles is also influenced by these ideas. Since sine is the y position of it, and cosine is the x position of any given point on the unit circle, the expression for a unit circle is formulated using these functions. This animation shows what happens when we plot them together. We get a unit circle. Now that we have an idea of what the basic trig functions are, we can discuss the topic of our video. We have a right triangle. It has three sides, two of which are our functions, and the hypotenuse, which by design has a length the same as the radius of the circle, and thus has a length of 1. The famous Pythagorean theorem from geometry tells us that the length of the opposite squared and the length of the adjacent squared of our right triangle add up to the length of the hypotenuse squared, which is just 1 here. Since we call the length of these sides sine of phi and cosine of phi, for the opposite and adjacent respectively, we plug these in and get our dear identity. Note that the sine squared of phi is the same as the sine of phi squared, and the same goes for the cosine of phi, just a quirk of notation. So our identity is essentially just an extension of the Pythagorean theorem. To finish off the lesson, I'll explain a more rigorous proof of the Pythagorean trig identity using a little bit of algebra. First, we'll begin with the trig ratios and our dear identity. We'll substitute our ratios into our identity. Next, since both fractions are squared, we distribute the square, then add these two fractions since they have a common denominator. To finish it off, since the Pythagorean theorem says that a squared plus o squared equals h squared, and since any fraction whose numerator and denominator are the same is equal to 1, this completes our proof. And that concludes the lesson. I hope you like this video and come away with some new knowledge of trig and about this fun little identity. In the future, I plan to make more videos of this style about trig and geometry. I only really scratched the surface here, and there are actually several more trig functions, and trig has so much more fascinating math like this that I'd love to share. Goodbye, and have a mathematical day.